Hello, everybody. In this video, I'm going to be presenting a proof that the sum of the reciprocals of all the prime numbers diverges. Now, this is a result that was first shown by Euler in 1737. It's a very famous result. And the proof that I'm going to give you is a modification that I made of a proof by James A. Clarkson, that appeared in Proceedings of the AMS in 1966. So Proceedings of the AMS is a very prestigious math journal, and he published this nice little proof of this well-known fact that's very clever, and I just made a slight adjustment to it that I think improves it even more. So the other reason I want to do this video is it gives me an opportunity to try out some new software. I've been playing around with some new video software and PowerPoint, some more to try and make a little bit more professional looking videos. So we'll see how that goes. So let's get started with the statement. So the theorem is the sum of the reciprocals of the primes diverges. So in particular, if we sum 1 over p, over all primes, so a half plus a third plus a fifth plus a seventh, and so on. This is a divergent sum, so we can make this sum as large as we want to. This sum does grow incredibly slow on the order of the log of the log. So it's a very slow growing sum, but it does diverge. So the idea behind this proof is to look at the tail of the series. So chop off the first few terms and just look at past a certain point. And what we're going to do is show that these tails have to have at least a certain magnitude. And of course, that's going to show divergence, because any convergent series, the tail has to go to zero in a convergent series. And it's kind of a clever argument based on geometric series. So let Pn denote the nth prime. And so the kth tail, Rk here, is just going to be the sum of all the reciprocals of the primes except the first k terms here. So if we look at raising this expression to a power I, an integer power I, then if we expand this out, what's going to happen is that that expansion is going to contain at least one term for every reciprocal of a positive integer with exactly I prime factors, counting multiplicities, but only from the set of primes, the k plus first prime and on. Okay, so this is a little bit tricky to kind of visualize. So what I'm going to do is go over a real quick illustration, and hopefully the illustration will help you understand exactly why this is true. So let's look at, for instance, 1 over 3,211. So 3,211 has prime factorization 13 squared times 19. So it's 1 13th times 1 13th times 1 19th. Now, if we look at, say, this R4, so we're not counting the first four terms of the series, which would be a half, a third, a fifth, and a seventh. That means we're only looking at the tail starting at 1 11th on. If we raise that entire tail to the third power, what we get is a product of three infinite series. And so this term, 1 over 3211, has to show up at least once in that expansion. In fact, it's going to show up three times, as we'll see here. So here's one way that it shows up. So you could have the 1 13th from the first factor, 1 13th from the second factor, and 1 19th from the last factor. There's two other ways that it's going to show up. So the 13th could come from the first and the last, and the 19th from the middle factor. And then, of course, the last way, we could have the 19th in the first factor and the 13th in the other two. So in general, there's going to be more than one of these terms, but we just need at least one. In fact, you can notice if you have the reciprocal of a pure prime power, then it will show up exactly once. But if it's not a pure prime power, it's going to show up more than once. But it shows up at least once. So what you can see from this illustration, in fact, is that every reciprocal of a number that has exactly three prime factors, not necessarily distinct, so counting multiplicities, is going to show up at least once when we raise this infinite series to the third power. But the point is that every reciprocal of an integer that is not divisible by the first k primes has to show up somewhere if we raise it to some power, because it's going to have a certain number of prime factors. So if we look at the entire geometric series formed by these terms, then we'll see that we're going to get all of those different terms. So this geometric series will contain at least one term for every reciprocal of a positive integer, as long as that positive integer is not divisible by any of the first k prime numbers. Okay, so from the illustration that we were looking at earlier, it just means it can't be divisible by 2, 3, 5, or 7. But what we're going to do now is show that there's a nice set of integers that's never divisible by any of these. So if we look at all the integers that are congruent to 1 mod p1, p2, up to pk, so congruent to 1 mod the product of the first k primes, then those integers look like 1 plus an integer times that product. So 1 plus j times p1 all the way up to pk. Those numbers are never divisible by any of those first k primes. So that means they always show up in this expansion. So every term that's 1 over one number that looks like that is going to show up in that geometric series above. And that means that this geometric series has to be bigger than this series, because every term on the right is included somewhere on the left. But now, this looks remarkably like just the harmonic series, because the index is just j, everything else is just constants. And we can kind of do a direct comparison test. If we replace 1 with j, that's going to make every denominator bigger, which is going to make every term smaller. And then we can just factor out j, and we see that this is greater than 1 over 1 plus the product of the first k primes times the harmonic series. By the way, that p1 up to pk, that's called a primorial. So we could say here that we're looking at 1 plus pk primorial. And so now we've got the 1 over j, that's the divergent harmonic series. So that diverges. So by direct comparison, the series all the way on the left, our infinite geometric series there, has to diverge. But when does a geometric series diverge? And these are all positive terms. It's going to diverge when the common ratio is bigger than or equal to 1. So what we've shown now is that this tail, the kth tail of our original series of the reciprocals of the primes, that has to be bigger than or equal to 1. Every tail, so for all k. So if every tail is bigger than or equal to 1, though, that means the tails cannot possibly be converging to 0. But the tails of any convergent series have to themselves converge to 0. So the only possible conclusion is that the series of the reciprocals of the primes must diverge. And that is the end of the proof. So I would encourage you, if you want to, go and look at the original paper. It's James A. Clarkson. It was in Proceedings of the AMS in 1966. The title of it is On the Series of Prime Reciprocals. And it's just one page. It doesn't take very long to read, but it's a very nice proof that he gave here. I just reworded it here in a way that it's not a proof by contradiction, and we're looking at infinite series instead of strictly finite sums that he was looking at. So hope you liked this proof, and I hope the presentation went well. This is my first time trying to use some of this new software that I hope to use for some videos in the future. So if you like this, please comment below or like, share, and subscribe. I'll talk to you later.